Hi, this is Evel Knievel, and I'm speaking to you to preview my action video. My associates made this video from film clip highlights of my American Daredevil career. The color quality isn't perfect, but I made sure that we did include the thrills and the spills in this collection of documentary tapes. We've also included press interviews and some background history of my family life and growing up in Butte, Montana. You will see my first jump over 15 trucks in Gardena, California, which then led to the Caesar's Palace jump in 1968 and other famous jumps at the Astrodome, the LA Coliseum, Madison Square Garden, Wembley Stadium in England, and of course, the Snake River Canyon and my steam-powered rocket SkyCycle X2 on September the 8th, 1974. You know, the ABC Wide World of Sports record still stands with 52% of households viewing my jump over 14 Greyhound buses at Kings Island, Ohio in 1975. I also comment on the beliefs I had, which gave me the conviction and positive attitude to come back again and again to beat the toughest competitor in life, death itself. As so many Americans know from their own life experiences, you can do anything that you want to do if you really want to. My entire life, I believed it was better to take a chance to win a victory, even though scarred by failure, than to not have the guts to try either. This video is dedicated to you American Daredevils in every walk of life, from the pioneers and astronauts to every American who works hard to have a better way of life for themselves and their family. We're all a part of the spirit of America, and I hope you will enjoy this collection of film. Thank you.
Seen 30 years of the great events on Wide World of Sports, and I think at this point you have a feeling for how difficult it has been to take some of these events with which the audience was basically unfamiliar and make them compelling. There were many people and many techniques that have been developed on Wide World of Sports over the years, but the best decision that we ever made was the first decision that we ever made, and that was to find a person who had the intelligence, who had the ability to articulate, and most of all, who had the sensitivity to understand the human drama of athletic competition. That was finding my dear friend, Jim McKay.
How many athletes have we seen? Thousands. And each name brings its own memory.
What a moment, Jim. Never has the image of the thrill of victory been more vivid.
That's right. The thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. The words have been quoted and parodied, used in headlines and analyzed by experts. When we scribbled them out a long time ago, there was no thought that they'd last for three decades. They simply seem to sum up in nine words what our program and sport and life, I guess, are all about. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. In sport as in life, there's a faceless fate that offers in one hand the thrill of victory while hiding in the other the agony of defeat. You cannot have the one without risking the other. And for one person's victory, there is another's inevitable and heartbreaking defeat. For 30 years, Wide World of Sports has been the highest-rated sports anthology show on television. Notice the four highest-rated shows. You'll see the names of two men who played prominent roles in our show's success, Muhammad Ali and Evel Knievel.
My name is Evel Knievel. I'm a professional daredevil. I wear a red, white, and blue number one on my shoulder because I think I'm the best. In my business, you have to think you're the best, you end up dead. A lot of people ask me why I do what I do. And I figure there are three mysteries to life. That's where you came from, why you do what you do, and where you're going to go. Nobody knows the answer to those questions. I really lead four lives. My first life, I guess, is the life that I have with my family, my wife and my children. That means more to me than anything. My second life is being a professional daredevil to the public. My third life is being a business manager of that daredevil. And my fourth life is kind of like my first life. It's private. It's things that I do when I'm on the road to kind of let myself go, to loosen up, to be able to take and handle what's coming at me down the road. When you do what I do for a living, you have to have a positive mental attitude. And if that positive mental attitude doesn't work when you make that jump, you have to be man enough to handle the circumstances. In my case, I'm man enough.
Little south side of Chicago, little battles fought or brought more than trouble. You see, you stand about 6'4". All the downtown ladies call him Treetop Lover. All the men just call him Sir. Now Leroy, he a gambler, and he like his fancy clothes, and he like to wear his diamond rings in front of everybody's nose. He got a custom Continental, he got a Eldorado too. He got a 32 gun in his pocket for fun. He got a razor in his shoe. He's bad, 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 bad. He runs around.
Jumped in the Cow Palace. I had a premonition that I couldn't make it.
From the very beginning, things started seeming like they were going haywire.
And the Hell's Angels were there. Here come one of them walking right down in the middle of the arena, in the middle of the Cow Palace, giving me the finger, throwing the bird at me. There were 15,000 people in the grandstand, and here there were women and kids and all families that came to see me. And you know, I always wanted to punch one of those bastards, and he was a little jerk, so I just rode my motorcycle up there and got off and just nailed him. Now four or five of his buddies jumped out of the grandstand, and they're all going to jump on me. The Hell's Angels are all going to gang up on me. So now the motorcycle racers and the people in the grandstand, the San Francisco people, boy, they went after those Hell's Angels. And when it was all over, they hospitalized six of those Hell's Angels, and two of them were in intensive care for, like, months.
On this particular night, he had a lot of pressure on him. I could hear that the bike wasn't sounding right when he was making his approach takeoff. And I knew myself, just by looking at that setup, that he had not much of a chance to make it.
I knew because of the takeoff ramp situation and the landing area.
He had two pillars that he had to maneuver that bike through, and I just didn't think he had enough room to do it.
These three guys, Roger Raymond, Ray Gunn, and Jack Swank, have always taken great care of me.
And everybody in that audience seemed to know that Knievel was not going to make that jump.
There was no way that I could do it. You know, that I could do it.
And I asked him why he ever attempted to do it, knowing that he couldn't do it. And he said to me in return, he says, what the hell do you want me to do? Give them their money back.
After I landed, the motorcycle went upside down on top of me and hit some obstacles out in the gateway going out of the stadium. And
to be honest with you, I thought he was dead.
I'm lucky that I didn't get killed.
There is in medical circles a widely accepted theory that the very act of taking a risk can improve one's physical and mental well-being. If that theory is true, this man should be very healthy indeed, for he has taken more chances more spectacularly than just about any other mortal within memory. In the process, he has broken his pelvis, his hip, his foot, his hand, his wrist, and his back. And for good measure, he has fractured his nose and sustained a severe concussion. Despite his injuries, he is not only hale and hearty, but is appearing in a movie. His name, of course, is Evel Knievel. And the movie in which he is both subject and star is Viva Knievel. The movie deals with a double challenge, the most dangerous motorcycle jump of Evel's career, and a vicious international drug ring which attempts to murder Knievel and then uses death as a cover in a scheme to smuggle drugs from Mexico into the United States. The film stars Gene Kelly, Red Buttons, Lauren Hutton, Leslie Nielsen, Cameron Mitchell, Eric Olson, Albert Salmi, Frank Gifford, and Marjo Gortner as Jesse.
Being associated with Cheryl Corwin and the people at Warner Brothers and the people on this picture, I don't think a guy like me could help but be a success, because they make you one even if you aren't. And in my case, they're trying to make a racehorse out of a jackass, but I think they're going to get the job done.
I think the good things going for this picture are the The fact that we have so many different types in it, it's a potpourri of different people.
Director Gordon Douglas is in charge of this potpourri, and one of his main ingredients is star red buttons.
2005, after advance, same guarantee you asked for, you got it.
What about the money you owe me for those bleacher seats you sold I haven't been paid for after the last jump?
What is this? Judgment Day? That's over right now. I am good and sick and tired of having rocks thrown at me. I've taken just about all I'm going to take from this outfit.
No pay, no evil.
Okay. Okay, well, you got to do is ask, that's all. Here. Here you are. Here, one, two, three. It wasn't a sellout, you know.
During the filming of Viva Knievel, we talked with Gene Kelly and others about the fine old art of taking chances.
The idea of risking is a special thing for special people. Bigger risk in making movies than there is in the average commerce that one undertakes every day and everyday business. I was a gymnast, and whenever I can grab anything with my hands, I'm safe.
Reminds me a little bit of when I used to play football, because everything is so sharp, everything is so tuned, it's like an instrument. And I think that can only take place when there is a risk involved.
But the champion risk taker of all time, at least in the world of sport, is undoubtedly Robert Craig Knievel. Are Knievel's fans drawn by a desire to cheer him on or to watch him die?
50% of the people go to pull for you and they don't want you to get hurt. And they love it when you live. 30% go not wanting to see an accident or see you get killed, but they don't want to miss it if it does happen. 20% go, I think, to see death. And not that they really want to see it.
Evel Knievel has risked his life on every jump he has ever made. Why?
You know, there's a genuine cult in America, rightfully so, who believe in the things that he does, and the courage that he has.
The courage that he has was vividly demonstrated by his near-disastrous crash at Wembley Stadium in London. Suffering from serious injuries sustained in his fall, Knievel insisted on walking out of the stadium. This is the studio's reenactment of the scene that occurred in Wembley Stadium. This is what it looked like when it happened. Evel's pain was obvious as he was helped down the ramp. But what made him risk further injury by refusing to be carried from the stadium? Was it pride? Was it showmanship? Or was it his way of saying thank you to the 82,000 people who came to see him jump? What makes the fans so loyal to Evel? And what makes Evel so loyal to his fans?
I worked in the copper mines for years. And I quit school and went to work in the mines. I went in the army and came back out and worked in the mines again. I smile when people ask me for an autograph, and I thank God for it, because I had trouble getting my checks cashed when I come up out of those mines, let alone not sign an autograph for people. So that might be the philosophy that I have.
He has something that communicates to the band, the stadium, wherever it might be, that they like him. They like him very much.
He's always very conscious about what kids think about him. That part I really respect him, because he really cares about kids and people in that show.
I think it's a real disaster to put a young child, whether it be a boy or girl, on a motorcycle on the streets. I think that is a terrible mistake. I think that anybody that rides a motorcycle without a helmet on is committing the biggest mistake they could possibly commit. I think it's a shame. The greatest compliment in life anyone can pay you is trying to be like you. And I've had a lot of kids try and be like me and do what I do, and I don't say that's all so bad. I'm telling them not to do it to the extent that I do it.
So many people get hurt skiing because they don't belong on that particular hill. So many people get hurt riding motorcycles because they don't belong on a motorcycle. So I guess it's preparation, having your act together and knowing what you're doing.
Having your act together is tremendously important in a picture like Viva Knievel, since it involves stunts of unusual difficulty and danger. In this film, daring motorcycle stunts are not the only problems for Evel Knievel.
I want you to know something. I think you're both the worst. real nothings.
And I think that it's going to work out well.
If any man has ever paid a price for the success he has achieved, it is Evel Knievel. Snake River Canyon, fractured nose.
If I'd have made all those jumps and there was no excitement, no tragedy, I don't think I would have become as well known as I am.
Wembley Stadium, broken pelvis, broken back, broken hand.
Well, I think things just happen and we have no control over them except for our luck and our own wittiness to try and beat the elements. You might say I kind of crashed my way to success. The Caesar's Palace thing, for instance.
Caesar's Palace, broken pelvis, broken hip, broken foot, broken wrist, severe concussion.
I decided since I love to ride a motorcycle so much that I could make a living at it, doing what I like to do, to go to the tracks and put on a stunt show. And I got hurt awfully bad.
To some, he is a hero. To others, he is a madman. But nobody can deny his courage. And if taking chances really does produce good health, Evel Knievel will either live very long or die very young.
Probably the reason I keep returning here is the fact is true, at least I found it to be true, that a man always returns to where his friends are. And since I went to school here and grew up here, I like to come back here to this locality, I think, because I get tired of the road life and the celebrity type life that I go through on the road, that this kind of offers a relaxation to me that I can't find anyplace else. My home is a home that I designed myself, and that it is a real home. It sits on 8 acres of the country club here in Butte, and the contractor who built it for me was a man who was the only man in town that would hire me when I was a wild young kid, who would really give me a job and trust me to work for him.
He was a good skier, he was a good skater, he was good in every kind of athletics, and I went with him everywhere. Only one time I saw him get knocked over the fence and lit on his head on the cement from the hockey playing, and I wouldn't go for a long time. And he says, "Mother, please come and watch." And so finally I went, and I got used to it, and I got used to seeing him knocked around. But he started the fights.
My real name is Robert Craig Knievel. Knievel is my last name. I'm of German and Irish descent. I don't know, really, a lot of people ask me how I got the nickname Evel Knievel. There's been a lot of children in my family. I have 5 sisters and a brother. However, I'm the only one they ever called Evel Knievel. They probably nicknamed me Evel Knievel because I was such a good little kid.
It was always scary from the very beginning. His first jumps, I know I would kind of hang on to his arm, and I think I bugged him a little, you know, until he finally told me that to leave him alone, because it was hard enough to make the jump without somebody bugging him. So I finally kept my mouth shut and let him do what he wanted to do, and this is the only thing that's ever made him happy. And we had a lot of fun doing this. My kids got to travel with us during the summertime. We'd go from the month of June all the way through September, traveled all over the country.
All your power comes down here when you hit. As long as that ball is even with your heel, use an open stance and hit it. I'll try it again, Kelly, see if you can do it right. Hit it off your back heel. Open your stance, just hit it easy, just follow through. Just hit it smooth. Attaboy. Being with my children is what I like to come back to, and the atmosphere that I like to live in for sometimes as much as 90 days, and then sometimes I get that cooped up feeling again, and bang, away I go.
I like my dad because he takes us lots of places, and he skis with us,
And he teaches us how to golf. And he takes us almost all over the world. And it's fun to watch him jump when he doesn't get hurt.
I feel that God loved him enough to give us this little girl.
When I pray and when I question God about God, I always say, God, if you're really there, since I'm alone driving this motorhome down the road, I'm between Albuquerque and Phoenix, prove to me that you're here. Send an angel down here in the middle of this road.
In which God placed a special love within her, because right from the beginning, she just loved her daddy.
This tractor and trailer is the longest tractor and trailer in the world. It cost me over $91,000 to build it. The coach that sits on the back of it has refrigerated air conditioning, electric heat, color TV, spot for my golf clubs, draft beer, a love seat, recliner. In the back, I have a wardrobe room, change area room. In the trailer, we carry the Ferrari, the Cadillac station wagon, the ramps, the jet-powered motorcycle, three performing motorcycles that I jump with, and all of our performing equipment.
He's quite a fella. Not too hard to work for. Gets a little uptight sometimes, and yells and screams a little, but if you just stop and think about what he's going through, I guess you can understand it.
All right, look, I got a bet for you. If you hit in the water, you owe everybody 100. If you hit in the trap, you owe everybody 100. If you don't par the hole, you owe everybody 100. And I'll bet you, fat man, double on a par.
You got it!
My grandmother could hit the golf ball further than you can hit it.
That reminds me of Little Charlie.
Go ahead and hit.
He's a little lighter.
Don't talk on Hans's backswing. Really upsets him. Good luck, Hans. Go OB! OB!
That could be out of bounds.
OB! Guy made $200 on this hole, ain't even stepped up to the tee yet. I'll bet you $100 you ain't past the ladies' tees. That's OB! That's OB!
If I cannot retire, I will at least retire every 6 months to where I'll need to do is get up on the morning and go to that beautiful golf course and in the wintertime take my little boys duck hunting and pheasant hunting and not have to work, not have to have anybody to tell me to get up, not to get up, what to do. That's the kind of a life that I want to live.
Unload the Ferrari and get that caddy washed up, and we'll split for Dallas just as quick as we can. All right? Hello? Who's calling, please?
The truth is that this motorcycle jumping business, for me anyway, has become something that is almost too much for one man to take care of.
No, this is his business manager, Mr. Forbes. He's not in. What can I do for you?
It's got so hectic that my telephones have been disconnected and unlisted.
We'll be in Atlanta, Georgia, the 1st of March for the Dogwood Festival, so we'll be in that area. Maybe we can work something out. But listen, we're in a hurry. We're on our way to Dallas. Why don't you send me a letter? I'll give you an address. Hello, Aggie. Yeah. Yeah, you betcha. I'm on my way to Dallas. You bet. You let me know what time you're getting in. I'll pick you up at the airport. Okay, buddy. You bet. Thanks for calling.
Well, I am my own business manager, my own PR man. I never had a business man or a PR man in my life. There's nothing in this world, I don't care whether it's furs, diamonds, automobiles, houses, anything you can name, that is the best that I'm not going to have two of.
Hi, good looking. You going swimming again?
Yeah.
Come on, I'll take you down the pool.
Kind of warm.
How you doing? Think you can handle that high dive today? Huh?
Out to have a good time.
What are you doing?
You have a little publicity nationwide or locally going for you,
And what happens is that when you come to a town, I don't care whether it's a small town or a big town, everybody wants to ask you a question and shake your hand. And I really consider that a compliment. I'll tell you why. In the business that I'm in, when the truck drivers stop shaking your hand, the kids stop asking you for an autograph, when the girls stop kissing you and the dogs stop barking at you, you're in a lot of trouble in my business.
And he jumped a bunch of our cars, man, and he demolished one of them. He just wiped that one out. I got to look at his body and look at that car and compare.
One thing about the guy, you got to give him credit because he has guts. The guts that won't quit.
What is it, guts or
guts,
sanity?
Determination, I don't know what, but he's a man of his own convictions, and I admire the guy for it.
He represents adventure, danger, the excitement in life, fascination that most people only fantasize about.
Anybody that can make a living trying to do the inevitable, which is kill himself, and come out on top.
Salute. I'll give a toast to him.
Toast to you.
Sure.
Even that little broad that gave you the kiss out there, she's pretty good looking.
Yeah, she was pretty good looking. I'll tell you what. My old lady's got 10 years on her and spots her 3 kids. She's about twice as good looking. That's all I can tell you about it.
Sometimes when I get up in the morning and have to go to the canyon, I don't care whether I'm flying or driving, I think to myself and I wonder if I maybe made the wrong decision when I stated publicly that I would try and jump across that canyon. I stand there and look at it, and I know that I could have gone down to the bridge and drove across it, and my chances of getting across alive then would have been 100% instead of maybe 50-50. You know, life itself is a chance, and I've always felt where there's little risk in life, there's little reward. Since I didn't have much of an education, I guess I let it all hang out because I like to live like a king, and taking risks and living like I do, trying to make as much money as I make. Now I have come to the point where I really don't know if it's all worth it, but I will jump the canyon. I'll keep my word. I think I'll make it and live through it. If you want to take a look at what that canyon really is, well, just stick around. We'll take a good look at it. The canyon itself is a little over a half a mile wide, and when I jump it, I may jump over a mile across it and land a half a mile on the other side. The takeoff ramp itself is only 108 feet long. The ramp itself, the dirt ramp that it's built on, will be almost 85 feet high.
SkyCycle is powered by steam. We fired the X1 SkyCycle, and we only did it to test the track. The ramp design people, the engineers, the contractors that have helped me with this thing are the best in the world. When the X1 took off, it went to the end of the ramp, out over the canyon, into the middle of the canyon, turned over on its side, and went nose first at 250 or 300 miles an hour into the water. The Snake River's so deep and so swift that by the time we got down there with a helicopter, which was immediately, and the skin divers, we couldn't find the vehicle. It was swept downstream, and we never have found it. When I get into the vehicle, I'll have a helmet on, I'll have a G-suit on. When I'm fired in this vehicle, the machine will go from 0 to 300 miles an hour in less than 4.5 seconds. As soon as I can see what's going on after I'm fired, then I'll make the decision as to whether to blow out of the vehicle with a parachute system or just stay in it and try and nosedive it into the other side, which is what I would like to do. That's the way I'd like to land it. When that parachute opens, it will slow the machine down to where I've got a chance of hitting in an impact area and staying alive.
If I make it across the canyon, I'll drop to both knees and probably thank God Almighty I'm still alive. And if I miss it and hit the canyon wall, it really makes no difference because I'm just going to get somewhere quicker where you're going someday.
and I'll wait for you. Dying is a part of living, and while I'm alive, I'm going to live it to the hilt.
Now, we'll have a much clearer answer. September 8th is the firmly committed date for the long-awaited Snake River Canyon jump. Evel Knievel will be either a national hero or a dead screwball. There is no in-between. Meanwhile, it's the business of jumping motorcycles, as usual, for Evel.
This week, our report on the Snake River Canyon jump continues with Evel Knievel visiting Mid-America, performing a series of motorcycle jumps, wheelies, and stunts for his fans.
On any Sunday, stretching up, reaching high, leaving my Monday world behind. I fire my rockets and explode in the sky, kick up my heels until I find.
A week now, I have talked about coming to this racetrack and doing a lot of wheelies and making a big jump. I kind of black it out of my mind until it's the time that I have to do it. Now's the time. I'm going to pay attention to business and get the job done.
When I first started to perform, people used to come because it was kind of out of a curiosity type thing. They wanted to see what an Evel Knievel was. Now, it's the thousands that come to be a part of the thing with me, that believe in me. Motorcycles that I ride are not souped up in any way. We polish and port and maybe do a little carburation, but there's no changes made to the engine. I don't use a tachometer or a speedometer, either one, on a motorcycle. I do it all by feel. When you come down the in run and hit the takeoff ramp, you have to be on the balls of your feet, just like when you're ski jumping. You have to be in a good crouch. You have to have your weight forward, and you have to spring at the right time. You do not turn the throttle off until the front wheel leaves the takeoff ramp. Some jumps I land on the nose, and I shouldn't, but that's because I thought I was going too fast when I took off, and I tried to slow down and nosedived. On other jumps, I'll land right on the rear wheel, just perfectly, just like I was going through the air doing a wheelie. I've tried to make it clear to children who might want to do what I do that unless a youngster wants to become a pro, I don't think he should even think about jumping a motorcycle or a bicycle, because the hazards that come up and the injuries he may sustain are just not worth it. The only thing you think about when you land the motorcycle is to hope that it lands on the rear wheel to where the shock absorbers take the impact and to where the front wheel will touch down immediately after the rear wheel. It should land in about a 40-degree angle, and that's a perfect jump. The biggest, and the highest, and the longest jump in eternity will be September the 8th. That one I will not have to look forward to doing again.
On any Sunday, like the tail of a kite, flying and dancing in the wind, I'd like to break the string and drift out of sight. I may not pass this way again. I'm flying over my shoulder through the dust. I'm calling, run word and catch me if you can. Sunday I'm a flying man.
A major part of the Evel Knievel charisma is his very convincing manner in persuading an audience that he knows exactly what he's doing. The location, the Midwest. The scene, a news conference with the main topic, Evel's Snake River Canyon jump.
So I'm not off 10. And when they fire that sky cycle of mine, it's going to go from 0 to 200 miles an hour by the time it reaches the end of that. And what that takes is 5,000 pounds of thrust, 15,000 pounds of jet horsepower, 4,000 pounds of total impulse. And that'll put me 2,000 feet straight up. That's almost out of sight. And it'll put me a mile across that canyon. And then I'm going to nosedive it into the other side with a parachute system and a shock absorber on the front of it. And this sky cycle runs on steam. It's a steam-powered vehicle. We heat water in a heater to 700 degrees and then let the water from the heater into the sky cycle. And they do the countdown.
Unlike any of America's 30-man space shots, where the vast technological resources of the nation and enormous scientific learning backed up the project, here's a solitary individual doing it on his own. True, he does have a rudimentary parachute system and some instrumentation, but he'll be mostly by himself, scoffed at by the skeptics, treated with disdain by conservative engineers. It's an old story, man trying to fly, and the first thing he has to defeat is doubt, and then prove that the improbable is possible, even if what is possible sometimes is unlikely. Of course, Evel Knievel is just the latest version in a long line of, shall we say, flight pioneers, men who departed from conventional design because they had an original idea, plus a certain desire to place their name indelibly in history. Ah, yes, there is an Evel Knievel in every age, in each generation, and from all nationalities. Those indomitable souls who reach out attempting the impossible dream. To them, we can only say, bon voyage, Godspeed, and back to the old drawing board, fellas.
There were a lot of people that thought that it was a crazy stunt, that it could never be done, and it was just for publicity. Well, I want to tell you something. When it's all over, I'll be one guy that'll come back across the other side and say, I told you so, because I am going to jump. I'm going to do just exactly what I said. And when it comes down on the other side, maybe they won't think that Evel Knievel was so crazy. You know, when Lindbergh went across the Atlantic, when he took off, he was an idiot. When he was halfway across, he was a damn idiot. But when he came down on the other side, everybody thought, boy, that was really something. That's what should have happened. So when you deal with the unknown, and you try and do something that someone else hasn't done, the natural thing for people to say is that it can't be done and you're crazy for trying it. But I hope that I'll be able to show them when it's all over that I knew what I was doing and that it was possible, that nothing is impossible if you really set your mind to it.
As we were saying, it is kind of unbelievable, but it's about to happen. And in the weeks ahead, we'll be following this epic flight as it gets ready. We'll be filming and we'll talk to Robert Truax, the rocket pioneer who has fathered the X-2, Evel's sky cycle. We'll show you X-2 as it's built and tested. We'll bring you the film of the strange short flight of the X-1, ill-fated predecessor of the X-2 last November. We'll talk to Evel and seek to find what it is that motivates the space-age loner. Crazy? Maybe. Implausible? For sure. Unlikely? Highly unlikely. Possible, just barely possible. He just might do it.
I think Evel Knievel is going to jump the Snake River Canyon because he seems like a really brave soul.
Yeah, I definitely think he'll jump the canyon. He
He's impressed me as an extremely articulate individual and knows exactly what he's doing. He's apparently got a good engineering background. I've got no doubt he'll make it.
How can any man get in a small contraption like that and go that far and expect to make it? It's impossible.
A man does whatever he says he's going to do, and he gives it a real good try.
He's jumped all the trucks and cars and all that, and I think he can jump in. He's going to wipe out in midair and fall down the river.
I don't know. I'm just scared to death for him.
I think somebody's got to be crazy to do it, but he's going to.
I think he's a pro. He'll make it.
Well, I think Evel Knievel's going to do it, you know.
I think Evel Knievel's going to jump the snake river because he always jumps things, and he hardly ever makes mistakes. That's all I
want to
say.
Oh,
my God.
I hope and pray that he makes his jump successfully over the wet river, is it?
And so the Evel Knievel Show goes on, spreading and building momentum across the nation as men and women of all ages become fascinated by this magnetic, if unconventional, would-be hero. Will he or won't he jump the canyon?
So on September the 9th, if you're somewhere, anywhere in this country, in a crowd or wherever, someone says to you, that guy should have never jumped that canyon. You know if he did, that he would lose his life, and he was crazy. Do me a favor. Tell him that you saw me here, and that regardless of what I was, that you knew me, and that I kept my word.
Oh, I feel that if a guy's going to be supposed to be number one and stands for number one, that he ought to jump as far as he can until he isn't ready to do it anymore.
Evel now lives in a place called Camelot, just outside of Phoenix.
If you don't have the guts to pull the trigger and get from point A to point B, which is 160 or 170 feet, which is across a football field, it doesn't matter what kind of landing gear you got, you're not going to get there anyway.
Let's go back, Bob. When did it all begin, as you like to say? When did you decide you were going to be a risk taker?
Well, I raced motorcycles for years, and the pay was so low at that time for motorcycle racers and hockey players, which I was both of, that I decided the public would support a motorcycle Daredevil show. So I put the whole show together.
Evel was a master showman who, in 1974, found the perfect place for the one-mile jump he had dreamed of. The Snake River Canyon in Idaho. He traded his motorcycle in for a rocket-powered sky cycle.
I'll jump it. And the only way they'll get me out of the air is to shoot me out with an anti-aircraft gun, because I am going to go. Believe me.
Five, four, three, two, one. Okay, Evel, stay with the bird, stay with the bird. It looks like you're going to go into the canyon.
You're in the river.
You had a premature shoot. You have a good shoot on that.
Come on.
Stay with the vehicle. Put your visor up if you can.
Evel Knievel is standing in the boat and waving. He is alive and well.
The parachute was fired by a drogue gun, which is like a shotgun shell. And there was so much G-load when I hit that fire button that it just blew everything to pieces inside of the canopy. I did not pull that ripcord.
How I ever made it, how I ever lived, is just a miracle.
Hey, good, he's okay.
Twin Falls, Idaho, they have a monument by the bridge. It's a dedication to the jump, and as far as I'm concerned, it's one of the greatest compliments that was ever paid me.
In every adversity, there's an equivalency to benefit if you just look for it. And as far as I'm concerned, if I'd have made it across the canyon, everybody would have said, well, it's easy, I could have done it. If I'd have died, they'd have said, well, the Daredevil died. Evel Knievel, that was his grand finale. But excuse me, I didn't. I'm still alive.
With the Snake River behind him, Knievel took off to conquer the world, and he introduced his brash American persona to the British.
Well, I think he's mad.
Well, I think he's a bit stupid. He's American.
He's a bit of a nut, but he'll make it, though. Because he's good and he's the greatest stuntman in the world.
Hi there. Can I shake your hands?
How are you?
Wish you all the best.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I don't really know about Evel Knievel.
drew over 100,000 people to the stadium. That's more people than they ever drew there for a soccer game between any two countries.
It's a turned-on crowd at Wembley Stadium as Evel Knievel returns to action.
I'll never forget, I was with Frank Gifford from ABC before the gym. I looked out the window of the dressing room and I said, Frank, what in the world does a person have to do to draw this many people to a stadium? And I realized that I might be slow on takeoff and I might not make it, but I knew Harley Davidson could never get the parts to me fast enough to change the gearing.
He'll be doing about 90 miles an hour when he leaves the ramp.
So I went ahead and tried it anyway with the gearing that was on it.
Evel has been doing this for the here he goes, and he will go. You see leaning over him is his mechanic, John Hood, who is also a close friend. The other man is obviously a doctor.
You know, I was hurt so bad after that jump. They never thought I was hurt as bad as I was, but I broke my pelvis right in half. I'm lucky that I wasn't killed. I was unconscious and up and in shock and could hardly get out of the place. I really didn't know whether I was going or coming. You know, we were on the air satellite and we were live, the ABC network back to the United States, and Frank was so upset with it when he saw me crash that he dropped the microphone, the ABC microphone, and ran down to help me.
Ladies and gentlemen of this wonderful country, I've got to tell you that you are the last people in the world who will ever see me jump, because I will never, ever, ever jump again. I'm through.
When I hit, I bounced right up over the handlebars, and I tried to hang on to that motorcycle like a raging bull going down that landing ramp, but I just couldn't hang on to it. And then it eventually just ate me alive. It burned me and followed me almost 100 yards right into the wall and landed.
Oh, I helped
right
pull it up.
Frank, what happened?
Hit a little short, I think, pal.
Yeah, just missed it.
That's enough, man. You've proved enough. Let's get the stretcher.
Let me get off the ramp. Please help me walk off the ramp. Frank, take
Come
me
on,
out.
I got you, buddy. Frank. Whatever you want. You got it.
Then we can look back now and laugh a little bit, but maybe you would have hit a few less five irons over the Thames River the night before.
Yeah, we were out there playing golf that night trying to hit balls over the Thames River.
You know, you told me when we walked in, it's too much. I can't make this. Then you went over and went to sleep. I don't believe it.
I was trying to forget it.
Evel had looked death in the eye in Wembley, and he didn't blink. But that was part of his makeup.
I'm not a normal person. I'm not afraid of death under any circumstances. I think that God put us here as human beings to do the best and live the best and be the best we can. When he's ready, he's going to take you.
The highest rated show in wide world history came later in 1975.
Believe me, after missing 13 buses in London, England, and then coming to King's Island and jumping 14, don't think I wasn't nervous.
John Hood is there with Evel Knievel, discussing whatever you discuss at this moment.
people at King's Island were so great with me. They're such a fantastic group of people and such a beautiful place there at King's Island outside of Cincinnati. But they did everything they could to make it as safe for me as possible.
The whole concentration now is getting that bike off the approach ramp and onto the landing ramp. And he's not hesitating. He'll go.
Boy, there's never anybody gladder in the world that was over than me when that jump was over. It really was the last big jump that I ever did which was successful.
Thank you. You know, I landed on number 14. I didn't get all the way across it. This motorcycle is the finest machine in the world as far as I'm concerned. It broke in half, but it held me up, and all I can say is thanks to number one, thanks to Harley Davidson. You've been so good to me through the years.
And I really wanted to quit then. It was the first jump that I'd made that was successful where I thought, now maybe I might hang it up. I did this. But, of course, I went on from there.
I made a statement at my last jump in Ohio that the motorcycle doesn't have wings, and a man who's supposed to be a professional ought to realize when he's jumped far enough to the point of no return. And I think I've reached that point, and I think the best thing I can do now is put on the shows and try and provide the best entertainment possible and try and stay alive and not get hurt anymore.
I admit I did gamble with my life, which is what other people didn't do, but I consider myself the ultimate gambler.
At the heart of my existence as a performer and an American daredevil was a system of values and principles which gave me conviction and confidence to risk my life and win my dangerous game. These themes of life are common to any American who faces the challenge of overcoming obstacles in his or her own path to success and a better life. A chance to win a victory is better than not trying in the first place. To be the best and to win against the toughest competition. To have the determination to get up again and again despite adversity. To keep your word and keep commitments at any cost. To remember, there is more good than bad in life. To keep your mind off of the things you don't want and on the things that you do want. To realize the importance of safety, especially children's helmets. To appreciate that fans make the athletes don't make the fans. To have a positive mental attitude in spite of adversity. To never be a failure by always coming back to try again. And to beat the competition. To be a champion and a winner. To take responsibility for your actions. To respect and be charitable towards those less fortunate than yourself. To really believe you can do anything if you really want to. To thank God Almighty you're still alive and remember that God put us here to be the best and do the best and live the best that we can. And that when he's ready, he'll take you. A human being cannot ask for a better deal than that. Always remember one thing. Each day, life is a constant battle at keeping death at a comfortable distance. This is Evel Knievel. One of the many American daredevils who make our country the land of the free and the home of the brave. I hope that you do too.